हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू क्रिएटिव मेडिसिन। इन दिस लेक्चर वी विल लर्न अबाउट
Bogdalic hernia. Now, in the Bogdalic hernia, which is also called as congenital diaphragmatic hernia, this is actually a left-sided posterolateral hernia. The incidence of this Bogdalic hernia is 2,000 to 5,000 live births is the incidence. So, it is seen, 1 in 2,000 to 5,000 live births you see Bogdalic hernia. The main cause of this Bogdalic hernia is failure of fusion of pleuroperitoneal canal on the left side. So, if you see, this is the lungs, and on the left side, because of the failure of fusion of the pleuroperitoneal canal on the left side, that is the diaphragm, the bowel loops will enter the thoracic cavity, and this will cause lung atelectasis on one side, and it will push the heart to the opposite side. Okay, so because of this, in these patients, there will be failure of fusion of pleuroperitoneal canal on the left side. So, because of that, bag and mask ventilation is contraindicated in these patients. Because there is failure of fusion of pleuroperitoneal canal on the left-sided structures like the spleen, stomach, all of them may herniate above into the thoracic cavity, and thus causing this lung, the ipsilateral lung, will collapse and it undergoes atelectasis, and the heart is shifted to the opposite side. That is, there will be right-sided heart, so that is called as dextrocardia, you will see. And this left-out space in the abdomen, undergoes herniation and it causes scaphoid abdomen. That means the abdomen looks like this. The left-out space the left-out space at the abdomen due to herniation causes this type of abdomen called as scaphoid abdomen. Next, if you see the congenital diaphragmatic hernia, in congenital diaphragmatic hernia, there is respiratory distress is seen. The patient will have dextrocardia and there will be scaphoid abdomen. Then, what is the most important prognostic factor? Pulmonary hypoplasia or pulmonary death is the most common prognostic factor which you see. Pulmonary hypoplasia followed by pulmonary hypertension is the most important prognostic factor and most common cause of death for congenital diaphragmatic hernia. In bag and mask ventilation, there will be massive amount of hair collected in the stomach. In bag and mask ventilation, there will be massive amount of hair which is collected in the stomach, and this further distension will cause collapse of the lung again. So, if the stomach is present here and if you fill it with air, this massive distension will again collapse the lung furthermore. So, bag and mask ventilation is contraindicated in these patients. So, if you see the diagnosis. So, in the diagnosis, first, during pregnancy, the mother will have polyhydramnios will be there, and at delivery, on chest x-ray, presence of gastric bubble is seen in the thorax. This gastric bubble will be seen in the thorax, and you will also see presence of bowel loops in the thorax. Coiling of the Ryle's tube is seen in the thorax. On management, the principle of the treatment is to reduce this herniated organs back into the abdominal cavity and then close the defect. For larger defects, you can use a prosthetic mesh. You can use a prosthetic meshwork can be used to close the defect. Mesh should not be used in children because the children will grow. Next, the next type of hernia which is similar to this is Morgagni hernia. This Morgagni hernia is actually also called as Larys hernia. This Morgagni or Larys hernia is right-sided hernia, or it is called as retrosternal hernia. It is right-sided or retrosternal hernia. In between the right xiphoid process and the central tendon of diaphragm, it is present in between the right xiphoid process and central tendon of diaphragm, you see a space called as space of Larry, over where the epigastric arteries are passing through the space of Larry. Superior epigastric vessels are passing through the space of Larry. If there is defective development in the central tendon of diaphragm, the space of Larry is enlarged, leading to the higher chances of herniation of the transverse colon. This enlarged space of Larry will cause herniation of the transverse colon, will herniate into it. Here mainly the transverse colon will herniate. This is seen most commonly on the right side, and the most common organ to be herniated is transverse colon is herniated. Then what about the treatment? Treatment is same. You should reduce the herniated organ and then close the defect. Then we have hiatus hernia. So what do you see in hiatus hernia? Hiatus hernia is the acquired hernia. Hiatus hernia also called as acquired hernia. So it is this hiatus hernia, acquired hernia, is most commonly seen in the adults. The type of hiatus hernia is, there are four types of hiatus hernia. First type we call it as sliding hernia, where the gastroesophageal junction will enter the thorax. So here the gastroesophageal junction will slide into the thorax. So this is called as sliding hernia. Then we have type 2. In the second type we have something called as true paraesophageal hernia. In true paraesophageal hernia, only the fundus part of the stomach will herniate into the thorax. So that the rest of the stomach and the gastroesophageal junction will also be in the abdomen only. Only the fundus part of the stomach will herniate like this. Okay, this is actually true paraesophageal hernia, also called as rolling hernia. True R for R, rolling hernia. True paraesophageal hernia or rolling hernia is type 2. Then you have type 3. In type 3, it is mixed hernia. It is actually, here you will see both sliding hernia and you will see rolling hernia will be seen in the same individual. That is mixed hernia. Then we have type 4. Here there is paraesophageal hernia will be seen. Okay, along with that, not just the fundus of the stomach, but also the bowel loops will also herniate inside, herniate into the thorax. So this is type 4, where the along with this fundus part, even the bowel loops will herniate. So this is the fourth type of hiatal hernia, which is paraesophageal hernia. If you were asked what is the most common type, sliding hernia is the most common type of, overall most common type of hernia is sliding hernia, that is type 1. Most common type of paraesophageal hernia, most common type of paraesophageal hernia is the mixed type of paraesophageal hernia, where you see both sliding and the rolling type of hernia. Next, type 1. Because of this gastroesophageal junction present in the thoracic region, there is no pinching action of the diaphragm is lost. So as a result, there will be reflex of contents from the stomach into the duodenum, into the esophagus, from the stomach into the esophagus. Next, that is the main thing is reflex will occur in type 1. Next, in type 2, because of this part of fundus, herniation of fundus of stomach into the thorax, because of that, there will be ischemia will occur in the herniated region, and this will result in abdominal pain. Here, because of ischemia, you will see abdominal pain is seen in this patients. Then in this, you will see both reflex will be seen and both abdominal pain, both are seen in patients with type 3. In type 4 especially, you will see ischemia is seen and there is strangulation are also seen. Especially the bowel loops will lead to strangulation can occur, or strangulation of bowel loops can occur. This is type 4. Type 4 hiatal hernia. Now if you see the investigation of choice for diagnosis is barium swallow is the investigation of choice for diagnosis, and treatment is actually laparoscopic hiatal hernial repair can be done. Laparoscopic hiatal hernial repair is done, which is the treatment of choice. This is done via the abdominal route. Then one more important thing, especially in the sliding hernia, is in sliding hernia, because the gastroesophageal junction is present in the thorax, there will be formation of ulcers in the lesser curvature of the stomach. The ulcers which are found in the lesser curvature of stomach, these are called as Cameron's ulcers. Okay, next. Then next we have stress ulcers. Stress ulcers are also called as stress gastric ulcers, or also stress gastritis, or it can also called as hemorrhagic gastritis. Okay, so first type is we have Cushing's ulcers. In Cushing's ulcers mainly occur due to the head injury. Cushing's ulcers occur mainly due to the head injury. Then we have curling ulcers. These curling ulcers mainly occur due to the burns. Cushing's ulcers due to the head injury, and curling ulcers mainly occur due to the burns. Then you have something called as stress ulcers. Then most common site of stress ulcers in the stomach are, stress ulcers are most commonly seen in stomach. First most common it is in the stomach. In the stomach, these stress ulcers are seen in the fundus of the stomach first, followed by body of the stomach, followed by antrum, and followed by pylorus. These stress ulcers are seen first in the fundus of the stomach, followed by body of the stomach, then antrum, then finally pylorus. Then we have stress ulcers can be seen in the duodenum. In the duodenum, the stress ulcers are seen in the first part, followed by second part, followed by third part, and followed by fourth part. So this is how the stress ulcers in duodenum are seen. Then you have normal anatomy. In this, we have upper esophageal sphincter and lower esophageal sphincter. Upper esophageal sphincter is present in 4 to 5 centimeters of length. The length of upper esophageal sphincter is 4 to 5 centimeters and lower esophageal sphincter is 5 centimeters. And if you see intra-abdominal esophagus, intra-abdominal length of lower esophageal, intra-abdominal length of lower esophageal sphincter is 2 centimeters. So, total length is 5 cm. In this, intra-abdominal length is 2 cm. Then, if you see pressure, normal pressure is actually 60 mm of Hg in upper esophageal sphincter, and in lower esophageal sphincter, it is 26 to 26 mm of Hg. In upper esophageal sphincter, normal pressure is 60 mm of Hg, and in the lower esophageal sphincter, normal pressure is 6 to 26 mm of Hg. In upper esophageal sphincter, the muscles which are present are distal portion of the inferior constrictor, cricopharyngeus, and circular muscles of the proximal esophagus are present. Distal portion of the inferior constrictor, cricopharyngeus muscle, and circular muscles of the proximal esophagus will be seen. Lower esophageal sphincter, factors which decrease the lower esophageal sphincter pressure is. Factors which decrease lower esophageal sphincter pressure include, we have drugs which decrease lower esophageal sphincter pressure, like we have prostaglandin E1 and E2, and also progesterone, prostaglandin E1, E2, progesterone, and we have morphine, and we have meperidine, then we have theophylline, then we have barbiturates, diazepam, then we have dopamine, calcium channel blockers, atropine, and nitrates. So, the drugs which decrease the lower esophageal sphincter pressure are prostaglandins E1 and E2 and progesterone, morphines and meperidine, theophylline, barbiturates, diazepam, dopamine, calcium channel blockers, atropine, and nitrates are the drugs which decrease the lower esophageal sphincter pressure. What are the drugs which decrease the lower esophageal sphincter pressure? They are prostaglandins E1, E2, progesterones, morphines, meperidine, theophylline, barbiturates, diazepam, dopamine, calcium channel blockers, atropine, and nitrates will decrease the lower esophageal sphincter pressure. Now, if you see the foods which decrease the lower esophageal sphincter pressure, foods like chocolate, then we have coffee, alcohol, peppermint, smoking, and fat. Chocolate, alcohol, peppermint, smoking, and fat will decrease the lower esophageal sphincter pressure. Then, if there is incompetence of lower esophageal sphincter incompetence, this is actually characterized by the length of the lower esophageal sphincter will be less than 2 cm. The length of the lower esophageal sphincter will be less than 2 cm, and also the intra-abdominal length. Length of lower esophageal sphincter will be less than 2 cm and intra-abdominal length of lower esophageal sphincter will be again less than 1 cm. Normal length of lower esophageal sphincter will be less than 2 cm and intra-abdominal length of lower esophageal sphincter will be less than 1 cm. Lower esophageal sphincter pressure is less than 6 mm of Hg. Okay, lower esophageal sphincter length is less than 2 cm, then intra-abdominal length of lower esophageal sphincter is less than 1 cm and lower esophageal sphincter pressure is less than 6 mm of Hg. Then we have GERD. In the GERD, incompetent lower esophageal sphincter leads to GERD. Whenever there is incompetent in the lower esophageal sphincter, so there will be reflux of the gastric contents into the esophagus. So this will cause inflammation in the esophagus, and because it causes inflammation in the esophagus, it will cause ulceration, and finally there will be fibrosis develops in the esophagus with stricture formation. And here you will also see presence of columnar metaplasia. Here you will see the esophagus, lower end of esophagus is actually a squamous epithelium. But now it will get converted into the columnar epithelium is seen, that is columnar metaplasia is seen in lower esophageal sphincter pressure, sphincter incompetence. Then if you see the clinical features, in the clinical features we have three triad. One, we have retrosternal heartburn, we have retrosternal heartburn is seen. Then there will be epigastric pain, retrosternal heartburn, epigastric pain will be seen, and you will also see regurgitation is seen in the patients. So what are the clinical features? You see presence of retrosternal heartburn, regurgitations and esophagitis is seen. Now most common presentation in GERD is history of long standing heartburn will be seen along with the regurgitation will be seen. Investigation of choice is mainly 24 hour. It is 24 hour ambulatory pH monitoring can be done. And we have a score which we get by pH monitoring, which is called as Demeester score. According to Demeester score, normal Demeester score is 14.7 or GERD is more than 14.7. The score, normal Demeester score is less than 14.7 and GERD is more than 14.7. So what about the management? In the management, we have lifestyle modifications are present. In the lifestyle modifications, there is decreased or cessation of smoking, decreased caffeine intake, and avoid large meals just before lying down. And if you see the symptomatic patients, in symptomatic patients, we can give proton pump inhibitors are given in the double dose. Double dose of proton pump inhibitors are given. Then before performing surgery, following investigations are mandatory. Before performing surgery, you can do 24-hour ambulatory pH monitoring can be done, 24-hour ambulatory pH monitoring and barium swallow is done. And also you can do endoscopy with biopsy is done. 24-hour ambulatory pH monitoring, barium swallow is done to rule out the sliding hernia, and endoscopic biopsy is done to rule out the Barrett's esophagus. Then if you see what is the gold standard of GERD, gold standard of GERD is you will do laparoscopic Nissen's fundoplication is done. For gold standard of GERD. Gold standard of GERD is you will see laparoscopic Nissen's fundoplication is done. Then what are the different types of fundoplication available? In the fundoplication, we have Watson's fundoplication, which is done at 90 degrees anteriorly. Then we have Dorr's fundoplication, which is done 180 degrees anteriorly. Watson's fundoplication 90 degrees anteriorly. Then Dorr's fundoplication 180 degrees of the stomach anteriorly you can do. Then you have Taupet fundoplication. In Taupet fundoplication, it is 270 degrees esophagus is rotated posteriorly. Fundus of the stomach is taken to 270 degrees curvature around the esophagus. That is Taupet's. See, in fundoplication, what will we do actually? This is the stomach. So we will take this part of the stomach. This fundus is taken, and this fundus is wrapped around the esophagus like a sphincter. Okay, this is what you do. The fundus is taken and it is wrapped around the esophagus like a lower esophageal sphincter. Okay, then we also have Belsley Mark IV. In Belsley Mark IV technique, in Belsley Mark IV, we will cover 270 degrees esophagus anteriorly. And the main important is we have Nissen's fundoplication. Then we have Nissen's fundoplication. In Nissen's fundoplication, we will do 360 degrees. We will wrap the fundus of the stomach. One part of fundus is taken behind the esophagus of other part of fundus and it is taken in front of it. Here this is taken behind esophagus and it is sutured here. One part is taken here and it is sutured here. This is the stomach. So this is how you see. Okay, this is Nissen's fundoplication. Now, then what is the most commonly performed fundoplication? This Nissen's fundoplication is most commonly performed fundoplication. Then what are the rarely performed fundoplications? Watson's and Belsley Mark IV, these are rarely performed fundoplications. Then If you see DORS and TAUPERS, these are actually most commonly performed partial fundoplications. Most commonly performed partial fundoplications are DORS and TAUPERS. Rarely performed fundoplications are Watson and Belsey is rarely performed fundoplication. And you can also perform Nissen's fundoplication. 360 degrees can be performed. Then we have upper esophageal sphincter. Upper esophageal sphincter is mainly composed of the oblique fibers of thyropharyngeus. Upper esophageal sphincter is mainly composed of oblique fibers of thyropharyngeus we have, and also we have cricopharyngeus muscle. In between the thyropharyngeus and cricopharyngeus, there will be hernia, the diverticulum. You know, the cricopharynx will form a diverticulum, and this diverticulum is called as Zenker's diverticulum. Herniation of all layers of the mucosa, submucosa, there will be herniation of all layers occurs through this thyropharyngeus and cricopharyngeus muscles, and this is called as Zenker's diverticulum. This Zenker's diverticulum is the most common type of esophageal diverticulum. Actually, this Zenker's diverticulum is a false diverticulum because only the mucosa and submucosa will come out of its diverticulum, but not the muscularis propria does not come out through this opening. Okay, so this Zenker's diverticulum is mainly seen in the elderly patients, diabetics, and in males. The thyropharyngeus muscle, which is present here, this thyropharyngeus is actually supplied by the nerve, that is pharyngeal plexus will supply the thyropharyngeus, whereas cricopharyngeus is supplied by recurrent laryngeal nerve. Thyropharyngeus is supplied by the pharyngeal muscles, whereas cricopharyngeus is supplied by the recurrent laryngeal nerve. This is due to this dual nerve supply, the neuromuscular incoordination occurs during swallowing, leading to herniation through the Killian's dehiscence due to increased pressure. Then in Zenker's diverticulum, the most common symptom seen in Zenker's diverticulum is dysphagia. Dysphagia is the most common symptom, and in more than 50% of the cases, you will see presence of cervical web is seen in more than 50% of cases. And also symptoms like halitosis and regurgitation are also seen in these patients. The main complications of Zenker's diverticulum are there will be increased risk of aspiration will be there, and pneumonitis and lung abscess will be there. In the patients, there is increased risk of aspiration, pneumonitis and lung abscess is seen with this Zenker's diverticulum. Then there is also increased risk of squamous cell carcinoma is seen in the patients. What is the investigation of choice? Barium swallow is the main investigation of choice, and the treatment of choice is you can do cricopharyngeal myotomy is done. Treatment of choice is cricopharyngeal myotomy is the treatment of choice, along with diverticuloplexy can be done. Cricopharyngeal myotomy with diverticuloplexy is done. The alternative procedures are diverticulectomy, and Dolman's procedures are the alternative procedures which are available. Dolman's procedures. This is Dolman's procedure where the in between the sphincter is broken. The septum which is present between the esophagus and the diverticula is broken, and this procedure is called as Dolman's procedure. This can also be done for Zenker's diverticulum. But mainly for Zenker's diverticulum, we do cricopharyngeal myotomy with diverticulopexy is done. Next we have motility disorders in the esophagus. The most common motility disorder in the esophagus is achalasia cardia. Then most common hypomotility disorder. Hypomotility disorder is also achalasia cardia. Most common hypermotility disorder. Most common hypermotility disorder is nutcracker esophagus. Nutcracker esophagus is most common hypermotility disorder. Then most common painful disorder. Most common painful disorder is also nutcracker esophagus. Then what is the investigation of choice? Investigation of choice is manometry. So, if you were asked what is the most common motility disorder of esophagus, it is achalasia cardia. Most common hypomotility disorder of esophagus, achalasia cardia. Most common hypermotility disorder of esophagus is nutcracker esophagus. Most common painful esophageal motility disorder is nutcracker esophagus. Investigation of choice for motility disorder is manometry, is investigation of choice for motility disorder. then we have to learn some important points about the achalasia cardia. So in the achalasia cardia, achalasia cardia is characterized by the absence of lower esophageal sphincter relaxation. Here there is no lower esophageal sphincter relaxation. So because of that, the patient, this is most commonly seen in both males and females. Here there won't be any relaxation of the lower esophageal sphincter. Okay, the main pathogenesis is there are two types of plexus in the esophagus, orbic plexus and Meissner's plexus. But in patients with the achalasia cardia, orbic plexus are only present. Among all those, orbic plexus are only present among the motility disorders of esophagus. So in the achalasia cardia, two types of neurons are present, which are stimulatory neurons we have, and second, we have inhibitory neurons. Stimulatory neurons are actually responsible for contraction, whereas inhibitory neurons are responsible for relaxation. Okay, stimulatory neurons are responsible for contraction and inhibitory neurons are responsible for relaxation. And in the achalasia cardia, there is selective loss of these inhibitory neurons. And thus the lower esophageal sphincter relaxation is absent. And thus here in these patients, the lower esophageal sphincter relaxation is completely absent. Now, in this case, what is the clinical features? The clinical features is, because of the absence of lower esophageal sphincter relaxation, you will see that the lower esophagus is dilated. Here the patient presents with dysphagia and weight loss. Dysphagia is mainly present for the liquids followed by solids. The patient will also present with regurgitation, dysphagia, regurgitation and weight loss is seen. There is also increased risk of aspirations are seen, and there is also increased risk of pneumonia is seen. There will be increased risk of aspiration, increased risk of pneumonia, and you will also see presence of increased risk of lung abscess is seen, which will also have increased risk of squamous cell carcinoma is seen. So these are the main complications. Then we have AAA syndrome. And what do you see in AAA syndrome? In AAA syndrome, you will see presence of achalasia is seen, alacrimia is seen, or you will see ACTH resistant adrenal insufficiency is seen. So, okay, AAA syndrome. In AAA syndrome, we have achalasia, alacrimia, and ACTH resistant adrenal insufficiency is seen in AAA syndrome. Next, what is the investigation of choice? Investigation of choice is manometry is the investigation of choice. What do you see on manometry? There are some findings related to lower esophageal sphincter in manometry. In lower esophageal sphincter, there is absence of relaxation and there is increased lower esophageal sphincter pressure seen in manometry. In esophageal body related, there will be absent peristalsis is seen, and there will be also ineffective contractions are seen in the body, and there will be increased esophageal pressure will be seen. Because of these food particles which get accumulated in the lower part of the esophagus, so this will cause increased esophageal pressure. So on barium swallow, you will see the presence of bird beak appearance or pencil tip appearance or rat tail appearance is seen on barium swallow. And if you see the achalasia can be of two types. One, we have primary achalasia. Second, we have secondary achalasia. This secondary achalasia can be due to malignancy or it can be due to Chagas disease. Primary achalasia is idiopathic conditions, whereas this secondary achalasia, which is due to malignancy and Chagas disease, is called as pseudo achalasia. Now, how are you going to treat this achalasia cardia? It is treated by calcium channel blockers. Nitrates can be given. We can give Botox injections or Bauji. You can take a balloon and you can try to dilate this lower constricted part of the lower esophagus. And mainly, what is the treatment of choice? Treatment of choice is you can do laparoscopic Heller's cardiomyotomy can be done. Laparoscopic Heller's cardiomyotomy is the treatment of choice. Then, after Heller's cardiomyotomy, you can do partial fundoplication needs to be performed. And that partial fundoplication, which is most commonly performed, is either DORP fundoplication and Taupet's fundoplication is mainly performed. Then we have per-oral endoscopic myotomy. In per-oral endoscopic myotomy is mainly used in the treatment of achalasia cardia. Though, so, in chronic cases, there will be massive dilatation of esophagus, you will see, which is called as mega esophagus and sigma esophagus. This is massive dilatation of esophagus, which is called as mega esophagus or sigmoid esophagus is seen. So, treatment of this is, you will see, esophagectomy is seen. Then, there are three types of esophageal constrictions. So, if you see the esophageal contractions, there are three types of esophageal contractions are seen, which is primary esophageal contractions, secondary esophageal contractions, and tertiary esophageal contractions. Primary esophageal contractions will cause progressive contractions, and these are triggered by voluntary swallowing, will produce primary contractions. Whereas secondary contractions, these are also progressive contractions, and these are mainly triggered by the irritation and distension of esophagus by the food, we get secondary contractions. In tertiary contractions, these are actually non-progressive contractions, and these are non-peristaltic spasmodic contractions. These are non-progressive and non-peristaltic spasmodic contractions are seen in tertiary esophageal contractions. So, in esophageal contractions, we have three types. Primary esophageal contractions, secondary esophageal contractions, and tertiary esophageal contractions. In primary esophageal contractions, you will see progressive contractions, which is triggered by voluntary swallowing. Secondary esophageal contractions are progressive contractions which are triggered by irritation and distension caused by the food bolus. Whereas tertiary esophageal contractions are non-progressive and non-peristaltic spasmodic contractions are seen in tertiary esophageal contractions. Now, if you see the blood supply of the esophagus. So, in the blood supply of the esophagus, in the lower neck, it is actually supplied by the inferior thyroid artery in the lower neck. In the thorax, behind the trachea, it is supplied by the bronchial artery. At the aorta, at T4, it has direct branches from the aorta, it will have. And at the diaphragm, that is at the phrenic opening, at the diaphragm, that is at the near its opening, it is supplied by the inferior phrenic artery. And at the gastroesophageal junction, it is supplied by left gastric artery. At the gastroesophageal junction, it is supplied by left gastric artery. So, in the lower neck, it is supplied by inferior thyroid artery. In the thorax and behind the trachea, it is supplied by bronchial artery. Below T4, anterior to the aorta, it has direct branches of aorta. Near the diaphragm, it is supplied by inferior phrenic artery. And near the jejunoesophageal junction, it is supplied by left gastric artery. Here, the arteries will penetrate the muscularis at right angles. Then, the next important thing is we have diffuse esophageal spasm. In diffuse esophageal spasm, we have tertiary or spasmodic contractions are seen in the distal esophageal spasm. These will produce spasm. Because they will produce spasm, these will obstruct the blood supply and these will result in ischemia will occur in the blood, in the diffuse in the esophagus. And as a result, the patient presents with left-sided chest pain and pain in the lower part of the neck. This left-sided chest pain and pain in the lower part of the neck is referred to as or is mistaken as angina. So here, mainly the patient has chest pain along with the dysphagia. Investigation of choice we do here is manometry is done as the investigation and the diagnostic criteria are first, in the manometry, you will see amplitude of contractions will be more than 120 millimeters of Hg and also the duration of contractions will be more than 2.5 seconds. Amplitude of contractions will be more than 120 millimeters of Hg and the duration of contractions will be more than 2.5 seconds. So, on barium swallow, you will see presence of cork screw appearance. Then you can also do barium swallow. On the barium swallow, you will see appearance of cork screw appearance will be seen and these are also called as pseudo-diverticular or rosary bead appearance also is also seen. Then antispasmodics include, we can give calcium channel blockers and nitrates can be given for the patient as the treatment, that is antispasmodics are given for treatment and if there is no improvement with this, then you can do esophagomyotomy can be done in the patient. So, in this patient, you give calcium channel blockers and nitrates are given. If there is no improvement with calcium channel blockers and nitrates, then you can do esophagomyotomy is done in these patients. Then the next important disorder we have is nutcracker esophagus. Okay, in the nutcracker esophagus, this nutcracker esophagus is the most common hypermotility disorder which is present. And this is most painful motility disorder. It is the most common hypermotility disorder and most painful motility disorder is nutcracker esophagus. The main clinical features of nutcracker esophagus is the patient develops with the chest pain and also the patient will have dysphagia. Now, what are the important investigation of choice? Investigation of choice is we can do manometry can be done in the patient, and in the manometry you will have to see the amplitude of contraction, and this amplitude of contraction is more than 180 millimeters of Hg, and the duration of contraction will be more than 6 seconds. Amplitude of contraction will be more than 180 millimeters of Hg and the duration of contraction will be more than 6 seconds. So the treatment for these nutcracker esophagus is you can give antispasmodics can be given like calcium channel blockers and nitrates can be given in the patient. Even after giving these, if there is no improvement, then you can do esophagomyotomy can be done in the patients. Then you can do esophagomyotomy is done in the patients. Then next we have columnar meta, then we have Barrett's esophagus. So what do you see in Barrett's esophagus? Barrett's esophagus, you will see normally it is squamous epithelium, it gets converted to columnar epithelium. So you will see columnar metaplasia is seen in the Barrett's esophagus. This columnar metaplasia is mainly seen in the lower part of the esophagus where the reflex can occur in reflex gastritis. So here the main etiology is it is mainly due to the chronic gastroesophageal reflex disease or it is associated with sliding hernia. Either with sliding hernia or gastroesophageal reflex disease, there will be conversion of the squamous epithelium to columnar epithelium occurs in the patients with Barrett's esophagus. The investigation of choice is you can do endoscopy is done in the patient and also you will take biopsy from the mainly from this area you will take biopsy, and in the biopsy you will see the presence of intestinal metaplasia with goblet cells are seen. In the biopsy you will see intestinal metaplasia with goblet cells are seen in the biopsy. Then how are you going to treat it? Obviously you should give anti-reflex treatment should be given. Along with that you should follow up endoscopy, 1 to 2 year endoscopy should be done as follow up, and you should also do biopsy in the patient. You should do 1 to 2 year endoscopy and biopsy is done in the patient. Then the next important is carcinoma esophagus. In carcinoma esophagus, the most common carcinoma worldwide is squamous cell carcinoma. Most common carcinoma in India is also squamous cell carcinoma only. Most common carcinoma of esophagus in the Western countries is actually adenocarcinoma. Then if you were asked what is the most common squamous cell carcinoma, most common squamous cell carcinoma is in the middle 1/3, and then if you were asked about most common cause of adenocarcinoma is in the lower 1/3. The most common site of adenocarcinoma is in the lower 1/3, and most common site of esophageal squamous cell carcinoma is in the middle 1/3. Overall, the most common site of carcinoma esophagus is also in the middle 1/3. This squamous cell carcinoma is most commonly seen in individuals with lower socioeconomic status, and adenocarcinoma is seen in patients with high socioeconomic status. Okay, now if you see the risk factors in the squamous cell carcinoma, the patient can have risk factors of alcohol, smoking, Zenker's diverticulum, achalasia cardia, intake of nitrites, nitrates and nitrosamines, fungal toxins, and also squamous cell carcinoma can also occur due to HPV, Plummer-Vinson syndrome, hot liquid ingestion, tylosis palmaris et plantaris, and deficiency of molybdenum, zinc and vitamin A. So alcoholism, smoking, Zenker's diverticulum, achalasia cardia, intake of nitrates, nitrites, nitrates, nitrosamines, then we have fungal toxins, and also HPV, Plummer-Vinson syndrome, hot liquid ingestion, tylosis palmaris et plantaris, deficiency of molybdenum, zinc and vitamin A. All these are the risk factors of squamous cell carcinoma. Now if you see the risk factors of adenocarcinoma, risk factors of adenocarcinoma are gastroesophageal reflex disease, high fat diet can be seen, or presence of scleroderma, gastroesophageal reflex disease, high fat diet, scleroderma where there is esophageal dysmotility and smooth muscle atrophy is seen, which can result in GERD, or it can be seen in Barrett's esophagus. So all these are seen in adenocarcinoma of esophagus. Then it is most commonly seen in 6th decade, and the most common site of metastasis is liver is the most common site of metastasis. And if you see the chemotherapy regimen is you will see epirubicin is seen with cisplatin and 5-fluorouracil. in chemotherapy regimen, you see epirubicin, cisplatin, and 5-fluorouracil are the chemotherapy regimens which are available. Then, if you see the clinical features, in the clinical features, the main symptom is dysphagia. This dysphagia is followed by weight loss is seen in the patients. There will be dysphagia followed by weight loss. This dysphagia, which is seen in the carcinoma, is actually progressive and it is mainly present in the for the solid foods rather than liquids, because there is a mass which is present, which is growing in the wall of the esophagus. So there will be small narrowing. The esophagus becomes narrowed. Esophageal lumen becomes narrowed, and as a result, because the esophageal lumen has become narrowed, so the solid foods cannot pass through them, whereas liquid foods can easily pass through them. Then the patient also presents with malignant tracheoesophageal fistula, where the patient presents with coughing, choking, cyanosis, and dyspnea. And also, whenever there is involvement of recurrent laryngeal nerve, the patient presents with hoarseness of voice. So if you were asked what is the first investigation done in this case, the barium swallow is the first investigation which is done in this case. On barium swallow, you will see presence of apple core appearance is seen on the barium swallow. The investigation of choice for diagnosis for carcinoma esophagus is, you can do endoscopy can be done, and also biopsy can be done for diagnosis of carcinoma esophagus. Then what is the investigation of choice for staging? Investigation of choice for staging is endoscopic ultrasonography is the investigation of choice for staging. Then in case of advanced malignancy or luminal obstruction, if there is advanced malignancy or luminal obstruction, then you can do CECT can be done. So investigation of choice for distant metastasis. For metastasis, you should do PET CT is the investigation of choice. So first investigation to be done in case with suspected case of carcinoma esophagus is, you should do barium swallow. On barium swallow, you will see apple core deformity. Investigation of choice for diagnosis of carcinoma esophagus is, you can do endoscopy and biopsy can be done for diagnosis. Investigation of choice for staging of esophageal carcinoma and the carcinoma stomach is endoscopic ultrasonography is done. Then in case of advanced malignancy or luminal obstruction, CECT is done. Then investigation of choice for distant metastasis is PET CT scan can be done in this case. Then first TIS, that is carcinoma in situ. So this is the, there will be carcinoma will be seen in the layer, but it will not cross the, sorry, this is squamous. Okay, this is carcinoma in situ. In carcinoma in situ, the cancer will be present in the mucosal layer, in the upper layers of the mucosa, but it does not cross the basement membrane. That is carcinoma in situ. Then we have, there is T1. T1 means it will invade the, this is the mucosa, this is the submucosa, and this is the muscularis area. Now the tumor will invade the lamina propria. It will invade the lamina propria of mucosa, that is T1A. When the tumor will invade the submucosa, when the tumor invades the submucosa, this is the submucosal layer. If the tumor invades the submucosa, then that is T1B. Then, if the tumor invades the muscularis propria, here, then that is T2. T2 will invade the muscularis propria. Then, if the tumor invades the T4 is if the tumor invades the pleura, peritoneum, and pericardium, and if it invades the azygous vein and also the diaphragm. If the tumor invades the pleura, peritoneum, and pericardium, and if it also involves the azygous vein and diaphragm, then it is T4A. Okay. Then what is T4B? In T4B, the tumor will invade the vertebral body. It will invert the vertebral body, aorta, and also trachea. It will invert the vertebral body, aorta, and trachea. That is T4B. So T4A will invert the pleura, pericardium, and peritoneum, azygous, vein, and diaphragm. Whereas T4B will invert the vertebral body, aorta, and trachea. Now we have N1. Nodes. In the nodes N1, these are seen metastasis to 1 to 2 regional lymph nodes. N2 shows metastasis to 3 to 6 regional lymph nodes. N3 shows metastasis to 7 or more regional lymph nodes. Then if you see M0, there is no metastasis. M1, there is metastasis present. So if you see the treatment, in the treatment, you will have to do esophagectomy is done with 10 centimeters margin. You will remove the esophagus taking 10 centimeters margin. Then you can also do chemotherapy and radiotherapy can also be given to the patients. Then the margins for esophagus, it is 10 centimeters. So if you see all the margins in different surgeries, if you see in esophagus, we take the margin to be 10 centimeters. In GI surgeries, especially in GI surgeries, the margin is taken as 5 centimeters. In distal rectum, the margin is taken to be 2 centimeters. In squamous cell carcinoma, basal cell carcinoma, or malignant melanoma, or soft tissue sarcoma, the margin is taken as 2 centimeters. Okay, so in esophagus, the margin is taken as 10 centimeters. In distal rectum, the margin is 2 centimeters. In all of the GI surgeries, for resection and anastomosis, we take the margin to be 5 centimeters, except the esophagus, where we take 10 centimeters, and distal rectum, where we take 2 centimeters of margin. Then squamous cell carcinoma, malignant melanoma, basal cell carcinoma, and also in the soft tissue sarcoma, all these will show margin of 2 centimeters. Then we have esophagectomies. Esophagectomies are of three types. One, we have Iver-Lewis operation. In Iver-Lewis operation, first and foremost, you will do a laparotomy, followed by thoracotomy is done. First you will do a laparotomy and then thoracotomy, and you anastomose the and you remove the mass and you anastomose this esophagus to this stomach. Okay, to this stomach, esophagus and stomach is anastomosed in the thorax. So there is first you will see laparotomy followed by thoracotomy, and the intrathoracic esophagogastric anastomosis is performed. Intrathoracic esophagogastric anastomosis is performed. Then low risk of anastomotic leak is seen due to increased vascularity at anastomotic sites. If anastomotic leak occurs, then there is severe mediastinitis can occur. So there is low risk of anastomotic leak. But if in any case anastomotic leak occurs in Iver-Lewis operation, then you will see that the patient will land up in severe mediastinitis, because we had made the anastomosis of esophagus and stomach in the thoracic region. Then what is the most common cause of death? Most common cause of death is actually the anastomotic leak. Is the most common cause of death. Anastomotic leak is the most common cause of death. So this is Iver-Lewis operation. Then the next type we have Oringer transhiatal esophagectomy. Here we have Oringer transhiatal esophagectomy, we call it. So in Oringer transhiatal esophagectomy, so in this, first and foremost, you will do laparotomy should be done, and then you will dissect around the hiatus. You will do laparotomy and you will dissect around the hiatus, and then you will dissect the esophagus in the thorax blindly. You will dissect the esophagus in the thorax blindly, and in the neck, you will give the incision. Okay, incision is given one in the laparotomy, and then you will dissect the esophagus blindly, and second incision is given at the isput and the cervical part of esophagus. Now, Ryle's tube is inside, it's inserted, and esophagus is excised. When you insert the Ryle's tube and this part of esophagus is excised, then after that you will pull the stomach towards the cervical region. That means here you will pull the stomach. When you pull the stomach from the abdominal region to the cervical region, you will pull the stomach and you will anastomose the esophagus to the stomach. Well, anastomosis, the esophagus to the stomach. Actually, the anastomosis performed here is in the neck. So, in Oringer's transhiatal esophagectomy, the anastomosis is performed at the neck. So, because it is performed at the neck, there is high risk of anastomotic leak is seen. But though there is high risk of anastomotic leak, morbidity and mortality is low because we are not opening the thoracic cavity. So, morbidity and mortality is low in these cases. And this is actually the most commonly performed procedure is Oringer's transhiatal esophagectomy. Then, the next important thing we have is McCune N-block esophagectomy. In McCune N-block esophagectomy, you will see, then you can do McCune N-block esophagectomy. In McCune N-block esophagectomy, you will do a thoracotomy. First, you will do thoracotomy, and after doing thoracotomy, one, you will dissect the esophagus. After dissecting the esophagus, second, you will go and do the laparotomy. Okay, and then after doing the laparotomy, you will dissect this part of esophagus along with the in the stomach, and then you go to the neck. And in the neck, in the cervical esophagus, you give an incision in the cervical esophagus, and you will remove the part of the tumor and pull this stomach into the cervix, cervical part into the neck, and you will anastomose the esophagus with the stomach in the neck region. So even this has this, the main advantage of this is because you are dissecting the whole of the thoracic region, that is esophagus in the thoracic region, there will be maximum number of lymph nodes are removed. And as a result, it is associated with low recurrence rate. That is the advantage. Increased risk of pulmonary complications can be there. But the main disadvantage in this procedure is there is increased risk of pulmonary complications will be there with this procedure. Okay, then what is the most common cause of death? Cause of death in this condition is pneumonia is the most common cause of death. Then you have done esophagectomy. Now what is the best conduit which you use for esophagectomy? The best conduit which you use for substitution is you can use stomach as a conduit, followed by left colon can be used, followed by jejunum can be used as a conduit. Stomach, left colon and jejunum can be used as a conduit. This stomach conduit is mainly based on right gastric artery, and it is based on right gastroepiploic artery. Whereas left colon is actually based on left colic artery. So the stomach is based on right gastric artery and right gastroepiploic artery, whereas left colon is based on left colic artery, whereas jejunum is based on jejunal arteries. So if you see the best conduit is stomach followed by left colon followed by jejunum. The best conduit for stomach is right gastric artery and right gastroepiploic, for the esophagus, the best conduit is stomach followed by left colon followed by jejunum. So the blood supply, the stomach conduit is mainly based on right gastric artery and right gastroepiploic artery. Left colon conduit is based on left colic artery, whereas jejunal conduit is based on jejunal arteries. Then if there is conduit of choice for benign disorders, like accidental injuries, and also for acid-peptic disease. We should use colon as the conduit. Especially the left colon is used as the conduit for esophagectomy in benign disorders. Then if you see the route of placement of esophagus, how do you place the esophagus? Route of replacement of esophagus is posterior mediastinal route is done for this placement of conduit. Why posterior mediastinal route? Because this posterior mediastinal route is the shortest route which is preferred for the placing the conduit. Okay, then preferred treatment of malignant tracheoesophageal fistula is, so we have malignant tracheoesophageal fistula. The treatment is, you can do self-expanding metallic stents can be put. For malignant tracheoesophageal fistula. Then, what are the prognostic factors for carcinoma esophagus? Depth of invasion, number of lymph nodes involved, number of involved lymph nodes, depth of invasion, number of involved lymph nodes, and location of the tumor. That is, cervical position, it has better prognosis, and also if the tumor is in gastroesophageal junction also, you will have better prognosis. So, the main prognostic factors depend upon the depth of the invasion. Depth of invasion is most important, number of involved lymph nodes, and location of the tumor, that is cervical and gastroesophageal junction, they have better prognosis. Then, the next important is about the leiomyoma. Leiomyoma is actually the most common benign tumor of the esophagus. It is located in more than 90% of the patients in lower than two-thirds of esophagus. And it is most commonly seen in males, and it is most commonly seen in 4th to 5th decade of life. It is most commonly seen in males, and it is most commonly seen in 4th to 5th decade of life. Then if you see the clinical features, leiomyoma is mainly, most commonly, most patients of leiomyoma are asymptomatic patients. Most common symptom of leiomyoma is, you will see presence of dysphagia and chest pain is the most common symptom of leiomyoma. The investigation of choice for diagnosis of leiomyoma is the main. The main investigation of choice for diagnosis of leiomyoma is investigation of choice is barium swallow can be done, and on barium swallow you will see the punched out filling defect will be seen in the barium swallow. That means because the leiomyoma is present in the wall of the esophagus, except the leiomyoma, the rest of the esophagus will fill off. So this will show punched out filling lesions are seen in the wall of the esophagus. Okay, then we have treatment of choice. Treatment of choice is enucleation is the treatment of choice for leiomyoma. Then we have the next important thing is Plummer-Vinson syndrome. Plummer-Vinson syndrome is also called as Patterson-Brown-Kelly syndrome or sideropenic dysphagia. This is actually a pre-malignant condition where you see increased risk of squamous cell carcinoma is seen of the oral cavity, hypopharynx and esophagus. So this Plummer-Vinson syndrome is mainly characterized by the patient will have dysphagia, especially in the esophageal webs. The patient will have an upper esophageal web, and as a result, the patient will find it difficult to swallow. There will be dysphagia, and the patient will have chronic iron deficiency anemia, and because of this iron deficiency anemia, the patient will have choilonychia, which is spoon-shaped nails are present, and the patient will also have achlorhydria with ectropic oral mucosa and glossitis are seen. So this is Plummer-Vinson syndrome. Then the next important thing is we have dysphagia lusoria. In dysphagia lusoria, it is characterized by swallowing, that is congenital vascular anomalies. The most common anomaly which is seen in dysphagia lusoria is aberrant right subclavian artery. Normally, if you see, there is no right subclavian artery. So this is the arch of aorta, this is the subclavian artery, this is right common carotid artery, okay, this is the left common carotid artery. This is the left brachiocephalic artery. I'll explain dysphagia lusoria again. So first we have dysphagia lusoria. So in the dysphagia lusoria, first in the aorta, so we have first brachiocephalic artery, that is right brachiocephalic artery, which divides into right common carotid and right subclavian artery. Then we have left common carotid artery, and then we have left subclavian artery. There will also be an aberrant right subclavian artery which develops. So in this condition, there will be an aberrant right subclavian artery which will develop, and it will compress the esophagus from behind. This esophagus will be present like this, between these. Okay, now it will compress the esophagus from behind. Now because of the compression of the esophagus, there will be dysphagia will be seen. Because of the compression of esophagus, you will see that the patient will have dysphagia, and also sometimes they can even compress the trachea. If it compresses the trachea, it can cause recurrent respiratory tract infections, and dyspnea can occur because of the compression of the trachea. Then On diagnosis, if you do a barium swallow, you will see that you will have to evaluate the esophagus. With the help of the barium swallow, you can evaluate the extent of compression of esophagus. And to see this vascular abnormality, you can also do angiography can be done to see the vascular abnormality. So if you see the treatment, in treatment, even the vascular sling is also, this vascular sling is actually repaired. Okay, next. Then we have something called as Skarsky's ring. Skarsky's ring. This Skarsky's ring is actually characterized by the concentric narrowing or symmetrical narrowing. This is concentric symmetrical narrowing is seen. In Skarsky's ring, you will see presence of concentric symmetrical narrowing is seen, which will cause where there will be restricted distensibility of lower esophagus. This Skarsky's ring is mainly composed of mucosa and submucosa, and this Skarsky's ring is mainly located in the squamo-esocolumnar junction. It is located in the squamo-columnar mucosal gastroesophageal junction. It is located in the squamocolumnar mucosal gastroesophageal junction. The most common symptom for this Skarsky's ring is dysphagia is the most common symptom for the Skarsky's ring. Here you will see the episodic dysphagia is seen where there is intermittent obstruction can occur by a larger particle of food. How can you identify this? The investigation of choice is you can do barium swallow can be done, and this barium swallow, in barium swallow you can see three types of rings can be seen. Type A ring, type B ring and type C ring. Type A ring is present few centimeters above the gastroesophageal junction. This type B ring is located at the gastroesophageal junction. This is type B ring, which is located at the gastroesophageal junction. Few centimeters above the gastro type B ring, you will, that is at the gastroesophageal junction, you will see type A ring also. And at the distal to the gastroesophageal junction, here in the distal end, you will also see type C ring will also be seen. So we have three types of rings. Type A ring, which is seen above the gastroesophageal junction. Type B ring, also called as Skarsky ring, which is located at the gastroesophageal junction. Type C ring, which is located distal to the gastroesophageal junction. So in Skarsky's ring, if you see the treatment of Skarsky's ring, it is incidentally detected in asymptomatic patients. So as a result, no treatment is needed. If it is detected in symptomatic patients, then you have to do esophageal dilatation can be done. Okay. Surgical excisions are not recommended because if you do surgical excisions, these can result in stricture formation. So surgical excisions are not recommended. Then the next important is we have esophageal perforation is seen. So in the esophageal perforation, the most common cause of perforation is iatrogenic perforation is most common, and the most common site of perforation is in the posterior wall of the cricopharynx. It is most common site of perforation. Now there is a longitudinal tear. Okay, so there are two types of perforations can be seen, two histories, different histories. One we have Meissner's disease, one we have Mallory-Weiss syndrome, second we have Borges syndrome. So in Mallory-Weiss syndrome, if you see here, this is mainly the main typical history is there will be an alcoholic who will retch after drinking a lots of alcohol, he will vomit and he will retch, and during that time in the stomach at the upper part, that is in the cardia, there will be development of longitudinal tears will be seen on the stomach, and these tears are called as Mallory-Weiss tears. Then second we have something called as Borges syndrome. In Borges syndrome, this mainly occurs in the spontaneous esophageal perforation, which is caused mainly by the forceful vomiting. Here, when the patient vomits a lot, suddenly there will be perforation which occurs in the lower one third of the esophagus. Here, a perforation occurs in the lower one third of the esophagus. And this Borges syndrome is mainly characterized by Meckler's triad, where you see a triad of things. You will see presence of thoracic pain will be seen with vomiting, and also cervical subcutaneous emphysema will be seen. There will be thoracic pain, vomiting, and cervical subcutaneous emphysema will be seen. In case of massive contamination and inflammation, there can be fever and sepsis can occur. Now, if you do a chest X-ray, If you do a chest X-ray, you will see presence of hydropneumothorax which seen on chest X-ray. Investigation of choice is water-soluble esophagogram. Is an investigation of choice. Investigation of choice is water-soluble esophagogram is the investigation of choice. And chest X-ray, you can do hydropneumothorax can be found out. Then, what about the management? Management is if you see the time of presentation. In the presentation, within 24 hours, this 24 hours is actually a golden period of repair. In this golden period of repair, you will have to repair the perforation number 1 and then you can put an ICD insertion can be done with feeding jejunostomy is done. Repair the perforation with ICD, you can put intercostal drainage tube with feeding jejunostomy can be done. After 24 hours, you can do esophagostomy should be done with ICD drainage, intercostal tube drainage is done and feeding jejunostomy is done. Esophagotomy is done with intercostal tube drainage insertion and also feeding jejunostomy is done. So this is about the esophagus.
Thank you and thank you for watching.